Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to St. Paul's. My name is David. I am the Dean, which means my own self-description is that I'm responsible for everything and in charge of nothing. And this evening is no different. So I'm just here to enjoy what other people have done. But just to say three things. One is a very warm welcome to St. Paul's, particularly if you've never been here. This is kind of down in the bowels. The crypt of St. Paul's is, I think, the largest church crypt in Europe, because it runs right under the cathedral. And up this end is where the kind of worship bit was for a long time for St. Faith's, a different congregation. And it was turned in the 1960s into the OBE Chapel as a monument to empire, which is one of the things that we're kind of engaging with at the moment. But you're very warmly welcome here. And do come back and enjoy St. Paul's again. You can pay to come and sightsee, which helps us keep the doors open. You can come and worship and pray for nothing, because that's the purpose for which we're here. Second thing is to say thank yous. Thank you to those who've made this possible. Particular thank you to the Pantheons Project in York and to Dan. A thank you to Simon and Jonathan, who are Head of Collections and Curator here, who have done a lot of work in making this possible. To Paula Gooder, who you'll be hearing about in a moment, and Paula will tell you a bit more about why we're here and how we're here, and to many others who've made this possible. And we are really grateful, and thank you to you for coming. The third thing is just to say a very little bit about why we're doing this, why we're here. One of the things that struck me when I came to St. Paul's 10 years ago was just how monochrome the cathedral was. Not just in the colour of the statues as they are in stone, but actually what they represented, which was powerful white men, where women, children, and people from across the world were kind of props in terms of their stories that they wanted told. And one of the things that we've been working towards for a very long time is how do we enable other stories to be brought into the cathedral, the untold stories, the things that people haven't heard and yet you need to know, to get a rounded understanding of the world as it is and us as we are, and to be able to confront the difficult bits of all our pasts. Because whatever our background, whatever our past, there are always hard things to engage with, as well as good things to celebrate. So that's the wider context in which we are, and this is the first major outcome, along with some work that's being done online called 50 Voices, which is from the Pantheons Project, helping us to engage and continue to engage with some of these difficult issues which are at the heart of power and the nature of our society. That's enough for me, so I'm going to hand over to Brian Knight, who is chairing this evening, who will introduce the panel. Brian, thank you.
Thank you. Firstly, let me thank you all for joining us for this launch, if still standing. My name is Brian Knight, and I'm a freelance journalist and oral historian. And as a historian, I'm interested in looking at how the past is narrated, remembered, and manipulated. So events such as this are of great interest to me. I'll introduce our panelists in a moment, but before I do, let me explain how the event will flow. So our panelists will make a personal response to Victor's work, each lasting 5 minutes, drawing upon their own particular areas of interest and expertise. We'll then open up the floor for a short time of questions, where I will ask you to raise your hand and wait as the microphone gets passed around. So please keep your questions brief so that we can include as many as possible. Now, you should have received a handout on arrival, and we welcome you to tweet and post using the hashtags and tags suggested. However, we do ask that you refrain from personal filming of this event. This event is being recorded and will be made available in due course. We'll promptly end the event at 7:20 and allow for plenty of time to view Victor's work and also enjoy some refreshments. So now it gives me great pleasure to welcome our panelists. So first of all, we have Sarah Ladipo Manyika, who is a novelist, short story writer, essayist, and founding book editor of Aussie.com. She's also a friend of the artist. We have Dr. Paula Gooder, who is a canon chancellor of St. Paul's Cathedral, which means that she oversees all of the learning and theology that takes place here at the cathedral. She's a biblical scholar and widely published author. She's also responsible for the art within the cathedral and leads the Challenging History Project, which reflects on how we respond to the cathedral's monuments in the 21st century. We have Dan Hicks, who is a professor of contemporary archaeology in the School of Archaeology at the University of Oxford. He's also curator of world archaeology at the Pitt Rivers Museum. He's a writer and broadcaster, and his most recent book, The British Museum, has brought issues of cultural restitution to a mainstream audience. This week, it was awarded the 2022 National Council Public History Award for the best book in public history. Wow. And finally, we have the artist himself, Victor Ehikhamenor, who is a visual artist, writer, and photographer who lives and works both in Lagos, Nigeria, and Maryland, USA. He has been a prolific in producing some abstract, symbolic, and politically motivated works. Victor has received numerous awards for both his writing and art, as well as fellowships from organizations such as the Rockefeller Foundation in America, the Nirox Foundation in South Africa, and the Norman Mailer Center in America. Now, would you please welcome me in welcoming all? So now we'll go for the panel's responses. So Sarah, the floor is all yours.
Thank you. It's wonderful to be here, and thank you all for coming. It's wonderful to be on this very esteemed panel. And just before this event, I was able to sit in on Evensong, and I was very struck that in the prayers, thanks were given to artists. And I just think that's a lovely thing to do, and the power that artists can bring to speak to societal issues is large, and so it's wonderful to have that recognized. So this is a very special event for me to be at. I have known Victor for many, many years, well before the art world at large has come to know him and his works. Back in the day, Victor used to send me his artworks. I've got quite a lot of his pieces for free. For some reason, he doesn't do that anymore. But on a serious note, I'm so honored and excited to be here to really celebrate Victor's work and to celebrate this installation. The last piece that I saw that was exhibited was The Holy King from the Sky, and I saw that at the summer exhibition. So I'm just going to speak very briefly, because I'm sure we all really just want to hear from Victor. But I'll say a few words about how I've come to know his work and how it speaks to me. So I've known Victor as a visual artist as well as a fellow writer. Victor is a poet as well. He is an essayist, a satirist, a short story writer. And for me, his body of work across the genres has many significant through lines. One of them is how societies govern themselves. Another is leaning in on the wisdom of elders. And a third is capturing the confluence of European and African cultures. And we see this in this particular work. So as I've written elsewhere about Victor's work both enchants and it provokes. His work depicts stories and histories that have hitherto not been told or not been given platforms or voices or indeed have been silenced. And this piece, this magnificent piece that we see that he has done, Still Standing, is a great response to Admiral Rawson's plaque. Rawson, as everyone knows, led the infamous sacking on the Benin Empire and subsequently made off with all the art. And for me, Victor's visual rendition gives us a fuller picture. Still Standing literally is a large picture urging us to reconsider the Benin Kingdom's narrative and story and resilience. It's a reframing of the narrative, a narrative that didn't give voice to the Benin Kingdom and to the Obas and the artists. It's a grand and majestic work. It's not sentimental. And it shows the complex intertwining of societies and their histories. So when you look at Victor's work, you'll see embedded in the work are rosary beads and bronze statuettes. And it's interesting for me seeing them, and this is the first time I've actually seen the pieces together, which is such a thrill, but seeing Rawson's plaque next to Victor's piece, and you'll see at the bottom of the plaque, there are military medals and badges, and the plaque is in bronze and brass, which of course speaks to for me, of Benin. What's also interesting for me, and I don't know if anyone notices it, the light is a little bit dark, but the plaque is on a white and green variegated panel. And of course, white and green are the colors of Nigeria's flag. So they wouldn't have known that at the time, but that's an interesting sort of echo for me. And you know, I just want to conclude for now by saying something that I think of as a writer, which I feel also applies to art. Toni Morrison, the Nobel laureate, in her Nobel lecture, says of language, something that I think we can apply to art as well. And she says, and I quote, "Language can never pin down slavery, genocide, war, and nor should it yearn for the arrogance to be able to do so. Its force, its felicity, lies in its reach towards the ineffable." And I feel that the same can be said, applied to art and artists, visual artists. The force and the felicity in Victor's work is in its reach. Here we have a reaching out and an opening up for conversation. Thank you.
Okay, Paula, now we're going to move on to you to give your personal reflection.
Thank you. What I wanted to do was to introduce you to some of the work that we're doing with the monuments generally in the cathedral, and then to reflect on Victor's response to Rawson's monument. So it will not have escaped your notice that we have a few memorials here in St. Paul's. I was talking to a friend a while ago about her church. She was a vicar of a church. And she said, I've got so many monuments in my church, I'm just not quite sure how to engage with them. And I said, oh, how many have you got? And she said, oh, five. And I said, we've have a few more than that. And over the past few years, we have been reflecting on how we engage with the monuments. Even as you look around here, you can see many, many of the monuments on the walls, on the floor. If you're interested later, just over there is Artist's Corner. There's lots of monuments to artists over there. Around the corner there are monuments to poets. Over there are quite a lot of monuments to clergy. And then as you go out into the cathedral, there are many more monuments to those with military backgrounds. So it's worth remembering that our monuments aren't just to those with military backgrounds. There are all sorts of people are represented here. Though, as the dean mentioned at the start, most of them are men and most of them are white. But nevertheless, we need to reflect on how we engage with these monuments, because otherwise they don't really speak. You have them sitting quite silently around us and you can't hear their voices. So one of the things I want to draw your attention to is our work in attempting to hear the voices of the monuments speaking. And here I need to give huge credit to the Pantheons team, two of whom are here this evening. We've got Jason Edwards and Marjorie Coughlin, and they have been working very, very hard since 2019 cataloguing the monuments. And I'm told by them this week that they have now passed 1 million words. So this is going to be quite some substantial catalogue of the monuments. It will be an enormous... It will be an enormous contribution to scholarship. There will be no other place that has quite the level of cataloguing that we will have once the Pantheons team have finished. So they are bringing to our attention the voices that are already in the cathedral. The other thing I would like to say is that when you come into a place like this, it feels as though the voices are quite static. They've always been here, haven't they? Well, no, they haven't. The thing that is very important for you to be aware of is that when Christopher Wren built this, and it was finished in 1711, there were no monuments, there were no memorials. The first memorial that was brought into the cathedral was nearly 80 years later in 1790. And from then onwards, it began to evolve and to develop. So we are in dynamic history, not static history, as it might look to us today. And one of the things that we have tried to do in the cathedral is to keep that dynamism going, and that through the medium of art. One of the most significant moments in our more recent history was in 1983, when they brought into the cathedral a new Henry Moore statue. And since then, we've brought in other new artwork, very significantly the Bill Viola video installations that you can see on the cathedral floor, the Jerry Judah crosses which are on the nave plinths. What we're trying to do is introduce new artwork into the cathedral, hearing new voices. So Victor's work fits very much in that dynamic tradition that we have of new voices speaking. And then we get to how we begin to have a conversation. One of the really challenging things about having many monuments is that you end up with a very one-sided conversation. The voices that are heard come from a very particular demographic. So how do we hear other voices? How do we allow other voices to speak into this important space? And one of the things that we have tried to do here is to come up with a project in which we begin to hear other voices. And that project is the 50 Monuments in 50 Voices. What we've done is we've invited 50 people from all sorts of different backgrounds. Some are artists, some are poets, there's a calligrapher, there's comedians, there's theologians. So people from all walks of life, from all different backgrounds, and given them a monument to respond to, and said, respond. That's all we said. Respond as you choose. And some have responded through art, as Victor has. Some have responded in poetry. But what we're after is a 21st century voice, a voice that speaks into this particular situation. And we begin to introduce new voices. Which brings me into Victor's work. What Victor's work does, sitting next to Rawson's plaque, as Sarah has already said, is introduce into our cathedral a profoundly rich conversation. I spent most of the afternoon standing, looking at Victor's work and at the plaque, and hearing, almost in the atmosphere, the beginning of a really important conversation about how we engage in the 21st century with our monuments through artwork. And probably one of the most delightful things that happened was watching the little children come past. We've had it's half term, we had loads and loads of families come past, and every time the children stood stock still and went, look, and they would kind of point at the crosses, they'd point at the sparkly bits, but they got that actually what was going on here was something new and dynamic and exciting. And for me, that's what we're doing here, is we're hearing a new dynamic voice in our conversation. And for that, we are enormously grateful, Victor. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Paula. Okay, thank you for that, Paula. And now we move on to the curator, Dan.
Okay, thanks so much. So it's wonderful to be here, and I have to pinch myself a little bit actually to realize that we really are here, that we're in person, and that we're here to celebrate this important work by Victor. Which, of course, let's remember, we're assembled on the eve of the 125th anniversary of the sacking of Benin City. That sense of anticipation of what will be marked in the morning is, I think, also paralleled, we're approaching that through forms of remembrance. This is a work that's about how we remember. And that really challenges us to think about remembrance and arguably repair in really different ways. So my role here has been to work with Victor in conversations that actually started long before the relationship with the cathedral, that started in Nigeria in 2019, that have developed through interactions with the colleagues from, you know, from the University of York, who asked me to respond to the monument, to which my response was, well, you've already got a text that says something about Admiral Rawson. You don't want another monument just written by me. Actually, Victor is the person to respond here. So my role as curator has been to work with Victor in terms of how to think about that monument in different ways. So for me, Victor's monument installed alongside a memorial that has been there for 100 years, which is about how that incident, that attack, that sacking, and the horror that was involved is marked in just a number of words and in the name of one man, to ask, well, how else might we remember? How can this event be more than simply about one dead white man? So this is about who is remembered, but it's also about how we remember, and it's about who is doing the remembering. So for me, Victor's work operates in a new and a very different regime of the monumental. I think it offers us hope that a monument need not be as we imagine monuments. You know, we heard earlier about all the different forms of the figures or the texts which we see around us. There are other forms of monument. And for me, I think, as actually maybe you will feel also as you see the exhibit, there's a dialogue with the poppies, actually, as much as with the monument. This is about remembrance for a time. It'll be here until May. So I sort of approach this as a museum curator. I work in a museum that has a large number of the Benin artworks that were looted in that incident, and which I've written about, advocating for their immediate and urgent return. And that way in which artwork, though, can meet artwork, that restitution, that crucial work of returning, can be met with things that are an addition, to work with Victor and, of course, to purchase his work, as wonderfully, with the help of Art Fund, who are here this evening, we have been able to. So what is absolutely amazing about this evening is not only as we, I guess back in the autumn, had intended that we're installing this work, that as we are able now to announce that we're able to acquire for the University of Oxford, for the Pitt Rivers Museum, this work. So after it has been on display here, and maybe toured elsewhere in the anniversary year, it will be a part of the Pitt Rivers collection in the long run. And I hope, personally, that we will retain it while returning the Benin items that were looted at that moment. So artists help us understand artwork, and they open up the space for remembrance and also maybe for repair. I guess in order to conclude, I just want to reflect upon the way in which the predicament of St. Paul's mirrors and is shared by the predicament of the University of Oxford and of our museums, because we learn from the environmentalists that we have to find ways of how to be good ancestors. We have to leave a world behind us that's not full of toxic remains, nuclear waste, the plastics in the sea, an overheated environment. And I think those people that work with nature in that way are absolutely right. Nature and culture, though, both have been subject to forms of extraction and forms of violence. So what is it that we share with those environmentalists for those of us that work not in the world of nature but the world of culture? Well, our challenge is, if you like, the other side of that coin. We have to learn how to be good descendants. We have to learn how to inherit what is of value from our museums and our institutions while being happy to face up to what is toxic and hurtful and find new ways for repair. In part, that's transparency. In part, what Victor's work does is it shines a light upon histories which these monuments, like Rawson's monument, have served not to make us remember, but almost to forget. This is like Michelle Wolf Trullo's observation that history is full not only of mentions, as he puts it, but also silences. And a silence is an act in the same way as a mention is. When we think about the past and talk about the past, we are making silences as much as we are mentioning histories. And he has this line, he's a Haitian anthropologist who was writing in the 90s, he has this line that to silence the past is like silencing a gun. There's a sense in which those aspects of the past that can be hurtful will still hurt if we are not going to mention and sort of face up to them. So I thank Victor for shining that light, which he does with his work, upon these histories. And I also thank St. Paul's for, you know, all of the team, yes, Simon, Jonathan, and Sophie, and everyone who's been involved in making this happen from St. Paul's, Paula, David, and so on, because it takes boldness, I think, to be happy not just to remain silent, but to allow these conversations to happen. So thank you all so much for that.
Thank you for that, Dan. Now, last but not least, Victor, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Baka talk, bae. First things first. Thank you. Thank you. For those that don't know what that means, you have to greet your Oba first when you are in any occasion. It's part of my tradition. And the whole point of this exhibition is to create old knowledge and create new knowledge and create enabling environment for a more robust conversation. I mean, a lot has been said, and I'm just listening to it, and I'm really, really grateful that this is how people that I know and those that I don't know are relating to my work and relating to this particular work. And I'm going to quote a much, much older artist, an Australian artist that I just discovered a few days ago. I went to Tate Modern. They're having an Australian show there by Aboriginal artist. I wasn't expecting to see the show. I was just taking a walk and reading all the captions, and I stumbled on John Maunjo. And what he said encapsulated everything I am doing or have been doing, and I couldn't help but write it down to be the opening quote for me. It says, "The old ways of doing things have changed into the new ways. The new generation does things differently. But me, I have two ways. I am the old, and I'm the new." That sums up what we're doing here. And the other thing is for us to kind of, I know most of us have walked through the crypt all the way to these places, and when you look your left and your right, there are things on the wall, there are memorials on the floor, probably some of the ceiling in some other parts of this great institution. And all are commemorative, all are historical, all are archival in that sense. I want us to take a minute to kind of imagine that, what that is doing for this country, what that has done for generations, and when these things were established. And they have been in existence, people have experienced it, way before 1897, knowing exactly this is how you prepare for the next generation. So when you imagine that and kind of now related to what was done to my kingdom, the Benin Kingdom, you then realize how so unfair to use, I'm in God's house, I don't want to use certain words. So how unfair, you know, so how unfair that is for you to know exactly the importance of archiving, to know the importance of even humans, to still go ahead and burn them down and excavate them and took them away from there. Just imagine that. Okay, because some of those soldiers that came, some of them as kids worshipped in this place, some of them as adults worshipped in this place, and Rossin's plaque ending up in this place is not by accident. They know the importance of commemoration. They know the importance of remembrance. They know the importance of keeping things for the next generation. 1913 was a few years from 1897. Okay, so when we are talking about restitution, when we are talking about conversations, when we are talking about having an equal way of looking at things, we tend to forget that there are people that did that to a different culture are very aware of what they were doing. Nothing was done by accident. That is where I want us to look at what I've created in this place to kind of remind people that what was taken from us were not just artifacts, we are not just art. These were ways of us keeping our history. These were ways of us knowing what our forefathers did. And that whole gully was created by us being taken out of where we were creating those things. That is what I want people to remember, and that is what I want these conversations to have. And in finality, the piece is a commemoration to those that were not commemorated, to those that were not known, the unknown soldiers, the unknown chiefs. Of course, we know of Verame, but a lot of soldiers fought with him, a lot of chiefs fought with him, some committed suicide because of the injustice that was done to him. And when you look at the photographs of Verame that were taken and published by the British press of the day, he was dehumanized. The king was given an ordinary robe and he had chains in his legs and his hands. So this standing is me resurrecting Verame. Thank you.